Aloha, I'm Kirsten Baumgart-Turner, and this is Sustainable Hawaii at thinktechhawaii.com, streaming live educational and civic engagement on the internet and Oceanic Channel 16. Today, we're welcoming back Hawaii water expert and former DLNR Deputy Director, Bill Tam, who's going to tell us about the benefits and challenges of pumped hydroelectricity storage as a solution to one of the greatest technical and commercial obstacles for renewable energy in Hawaii. This is how to store intermittent renewable energy production so that it can be accessed when it is most needed. You may remember that Bill has joined us last month, and he's been championing water justice in Hawaii for 40 years. He's here to tell us today why pumped hydro storage is a potential or not solution for Hawaii. Welcome back, Bill. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks very much.
I really appreciate that you have extended your water knowledge beyond just the ecological values that are so important to you, and I know you shared your interest in customary and traditional water rights, but now you're taking that beyond to some renewable energy applications and other benefits for Hawaii. So tell us what pumped hydro storage is.
Sure. This is really an economic decision about how do you make wind and photovoltaic hard, firm power over the long term. Right now they're intermittent. The wind stops, you don't get power from that. Or if the clouds come, or at night, you don't get photovoltaic. So the electric company is always concerned about, one, reliability, and two, the uncertainty of those sources. So what storage does, and why it's the key to the future, is it takes that uncertainty and it flattens it out. And I'll explain that in just a minute. We can talk about how it
gives an energy balancing or firming up of the power?
It allows you to essentially take the cheaper now wind energy and sun, photovoltaic, during the day, store it, and then use it during peak load. I mean, the problem for most...
And peak load is when there's the greatest demand on the utility grid.
That's right. So during the day, the amount of energy needed varies a lot. It tends to peak toward the late afternoon, evening. People go home, they cook, they turn on the air conditioners or whatever. So that, how does a utility handle that peak? And that's why they have to build more generators. One of the things storage could do is take that energy that's generated at night, for example, from wind, or photovoltaic during the day when you have more than you need, and store it, is to flatten out that demand curve. Because what that ends up doing is delaying the number of years until you have to build another power plant, or perhaps postpone it for a long time.
Before we get into the mechanics of what the benefit is, let's look at the mechanics of what is the stored, pumped hydro storage.
If you look at the slide that we brought, this is the simple concept. You have two reservoirs generally. There are varieties of this, but two reservoirs. And when you want the energy, like any hydroelectric project, the water is from the dam or reservoir above, and it comes through a simple pipe, goes to a turbine, and drives. You're basically using gravity. And then it goes down to the lower reservoir. In a normal mainland style run of the river project, you put the reservoir up and you dam up a river and the water comes down and keeps going. The risk of that is that you're interfering with the fish life, the biota of the streams, and you're altering the dynamics of that river. One of the benefits of this project, or this style here, is you could do this in the desert if you wanted to, or you need elevation, but you could put it in a place that doesn't involve a river, which is an incredible environmental benefit. So what you end up doing is you fill up two basins, and you have a pipe that goes either way. So during the daytime, you drop it when you need the energy, and then either at night or when you have a lot of photovoltaic that's cheap, because photovoltaic's been dropping. It's now less than 10 cents a kilowatt hour. By comparison, on Maui, in the recent rate case, they estimated their costs at over 37 cents a kilowatt hour. So you're getting that difference.
But the mechanics of it is that in the dropping,
right,
you're creating just the same as a hydroelectric dam
will, right,
create the same energy using turbines to,
right,
create electricity.
And then
you're using electricity to,
right,
pump that back up.
Right.
And so one of the issues that I know that people have with pumped storage hydro is the fact that it actually may take more energy to pump it up than you get coming down.
It is a net user. But from an economic point of view, it's a net user at the right time, and that's what's different. You don't have the problems associated with other hydroelectric because, for example, if you have a lot of photovoltaic, like Kauai or the leeward sides of the islands, that energy is available to you during the say, the afternoon or the morning, more than you can use. And so this is a question of how you can store it. And some people talk about battery storage versus hydroelectric storage. We'll get to that in a minute.
The other benefit that you're pointing to, then, is that not only is it providing the storage, but it's allowing those renewable energies to use their full capacity.
Correct.
And not be curtailed.
Right. Curtailment is a major problem because when there's more energy during the day being used, for example, or being developed or generated, like photovoltaic and wind, you might have more than you need. They have to curtail it. Then you're not getting the benefit of that cheaper energy. So this is a way to take the benefits of the cheap energy, store it, and use it at a time when it's more expensive. So you're basically generating when cheap, using it when it's sending the water back up when it's expensive or inexpensive. So let's look at the mechanics a little bit further, because if you go to the next slide, I think you can see sort of in a schematic form, when the reservoir is full on the left side and you're pumping it up, say at night, you fill it up. And then when you need to on the right side, you're dropping that down. So what's interesting about the hydroelectric is you're not using any fuel. Fuel is basically the weight of the water going downhill. It's gravity. So we're not sending, right now we spend $3-5 billion a year on fuel. In fact, on Maui in 2013, roughly half of the total cost of electricity was fuel. So you're not having to bring that in and send Hawaii dollars out. You're keeping your money at home. Once you build a hydroelectric project, these are very simple mechanically. They're elegant. I mean, there's a run-of-the-river project in Wainiha, for example, has been around for 80 years. So long as you maintain it, it functions. So you're not incurring fuel costs. Taking that off the plate is one of the most significant things you can possibly do. Murray Clay at Ulupono last August gave a paper in the energy conference on comparing different fuels and the capital costs of doing them. He happened to be comparing fossil fuels with LNG, and so that was what the headlines in the paper were about. But almost as a throwaway, but what I thought was the most significant result of his study was a Monte Carlo analysis of different scenarios, was that the choice of the fuel is 20, 25 times more significant than the capital costs over maybe a 30-year period. So choosing your fuel over the long run is the most significant thing you can do. If we're choosing a fuel with pumped hydroelectric that is essentially gravity and water.
And we're using renewables in order to do the initial pumping, so the energy that it takes to do that pumping, we could be using wind or solar for that as well.
Right. Right now we're throwing a lot of that away. And so what this does is keep dollars in Hawaii. You're taking the energy when it's cheap to build it at night or during the day when it's hot and there's extra. You're storing it, and then you're releasing it at peak load time. So you're postponing the need for new generating plants. You're flattening your demand curve, and we'll get to a picture on that in a moment. It also has no carbon emissions, or almost none. You don't have a fuel like a battery, which you eventually have to dispose of, like what's in a lithium battery or other kinds of liquid metal batteries. Batteries are developing, but batteries right now are still a risky investment because you don't know as they move along what their lifespan is. For example, it might be 7 years, it might be 10 years, maybe 12. You got to dispose of them, then you've got to buy a whole new set of batteries. Now they are in a smaller, they're more compact, and they do have some virtues in small circumstances.
They're more energy efficient.
They are a little bit, yeah. But hydroelectric, pumped hydroelectric is between 75 and 80% efficient. You're not doing it to generate net energy beyond what you use. You're doing it to control your grid and provide reliable, immediate energy. You can turn the water into the pipe and get the hydroelectric pump up and running very quickly. So it is a very good alternative to the problems of peak load demand, which is where we have our most problems. So looking at, and I should add one other thing, financially this has to work. So you don't want to build a project that's more expensive than what you've got now. But what you've got now is great variability in oil prices, for example. So the idea that you choose a fuel or a project based on today's prices, oil's at $30 a barrel. Now, that's not going to stay. But you've got to start thinking about what's it look like over 30 or 40 years. So you're investing for something that will last a long time. You don't want to have to redo this in 10 years. So the capital costs are obviously higher, but the way to finance that, it's not that complex. You issue a bond. You have a 20, 25-year bond, and you pay it off. And after that, the project's still good for another 40, 50, 60 years, and you've paid off your whole cost of your project other than maintenance.
Well, let's look at it, though, compared to some of the other technologies that are out there for storage.
Okay.
For example, you know, I know there's many different scientific ways in which it's used. We have storage batteries, which you mentioned, which is a chemical.
Right.
Well, I guess hydrogen electrolysis is a chemical, whereas the batteries is more of a thermochemical process.
The problem right now with a variety of these choices is that the materials you have to use to store it are often short-term. They often heat up a lot. Batteries, one of the problems with lithium batteries is if you put too many of them close to each other, they get very hot. If you ever get a fire, you can't put that out. It has to burn through. So while batteries, we think of our cell phone as a battery, but if you have too many of those in one place, airlines, for example, for a long time would not allow the transport of a lot of lithium batteries in one place. So obviously there are new things being worked on, but those technologies have limits. And disposing of them, for example, let's say you had a 10-year battery, you still have to dispose of it someplace and then buy the whole new set again. So I think one of the things we need to be conscious of is when we do the hydroelectric projects or we do energy projects, we also have to figure out how it relates with water, and that's why I got interested. For example, if you had a wastewater treatment facility and treated water to R1 level, you could take that water and put it in the system. You could do something on the leeward side of Oahu, on Maui, Parker Ranch, and all you basically need is elevation and a place for two reservoirs. You could put all of it underground. It wouldn't have to be visible at all. You could plant forest over it if you wanted. Once you have it in place and with maintenance, you could use that land for other purposes. And the water you put in could be salt water if you wanted to. I mean, but that's probably not good for the equipment. You could use reused wastewater. You could use groundwater. But once you fill it up, it goes in a loop. You're not taking it out of a stream. You're not affecting the fish life at all. So you could take a dry area in Kona, for example, take an elevation that's appropriate for the size you want, say a 40 or 50 megawatt plant, build two holes in the ground. Now, these are not dams like on the mainland with big faces that could collapse. They're essentially a hole in the ground here and a hole in the ground here and two pipes.
Right. Well, when we come back from our break, let's talk a little bit more about how it compares, though, to the other technologies, and you convince us. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Donna Blanchard. I'm the host of Center Stage here on Think Tech Hawaii. I hope that you will tune in and watch the show. It is inspiring and uplifting and educational also. We talk with artists of all different ilk. We talk with them about what they do, how they do it, and most importantly, most dear to my heart, why they do it. And it never ceases to be fascinating when you get the answer to that question. I hope you'll join us on Center Stage, 2 o'clock Wednesday afternoons. Aloha.
Hi, I'm Stan, the Energy Man, Stan Osterman, and I'm here to tell you about my show on Friday, every Friday, on my lunch hour, 12 o'clock till 1 o'clock here on Think Tech Hawaii. We talk about everything energy and anything you ever wanted to know about energy. So we're full of energy, and we'll see you here every Friday at noon to 1. Aloha.
Hi, you're back with Sustainable Hawaii, and Bill Tam is telling us all about the solution of pumped storage hydro. And before we went to break, you were giving us some real benefits for pumped storage hydro. But I want to look at all the other storage technologies as well, because I imagine our viewers will wonder why the new battery rollouts from Tesla, for example, and Blue Ion and our own Hawaii Blue Energies company. And I understand there's also a sodium sulfide battery that was put into a large-scale wind farm in Japan. So there are some commercial applications of batteries now for the first time, whereas pumped storage hydro has been the only commercial storage solution for a long time. You mentioned a few of those downsides to the battery, but I imagine from a technology perspective, they're beginning to address those. What are some of the other downs to pumped storage hydro that we could look at and say, here's how we can address those?
One of the downsides of pumped storage hydro is it requires geography. You have to have elevation, you have to have two places where you put reservoirs or tanks, and you have to have an easement down that pipeline. So it takes more space. Hawaii does have places that are not being used where you could do that, where you could use that elevation difference, but you're taking more space. Batteries, like you said, are more compact, they're mobile, but the batteries you've mentioned are mostly small applications. To deal with a utility level storage issue, you're talking 40 or 50 megawatts. Now that is a large amount of energy. That requires a lot more than what batteries could now do. Batteries are getting better. There's some recent developments at MIT that are really interesting, but they're still not scalable to the level of a full utility yet, where you would have reliance upon that exclusively. Remember, reliability for a utility is critical, because while hospitals have generators, most of downtown Honolulu, for example, does not have its own energy sources. If the batteries had a fire, if they failed in some way, if you had to replace them and couldn't get them at that scale, then you don't have a source of energy to store. And if your system is dependent upon having a system of storage, then you are in trouble. And so the reliability of those at a commercial scale, I mean, and at a utility scale, it's not there yet.
But you mentioned having the batteries downtown because they're mobile is a good solution. How do you locate the hydro, pump storage hydro, to serve all the different areas?
Well, you'd be integrated into the grid. So for example, if you were on Maui and you put up took an existing reservoir that's Mauka and built a pipeline down to another area and built a reservoir, that would be connected to the grid. So you're not, that doesn't depend on being located close to the use, it just depends on being hooked into it. And if you did that in combination with other utilities, for example, the reuse wastewater facilities, then you're combining things in a way that's interesting. That's where the synergies come.
Uh-huh.
And that's what we haven't done yet. That is where we're going to have to think out 20, 30, 40 years and say, what is it going to look like? Because it's not going to look like what it is today.
And you mentioned that we haven't done yet. Pump storage hydro is actually quite pervasive on the mainland, right? And I understand there's over 100 gigawatts of pumped storage hydro in the USA, or in the world?
Yes, in the world.
In the world.
And it's been around for 80 years, but it hasn't matured the way it has in the last 5 or 10 years, because people are suddenly realizing you can do it in this closed loop fashion. You can do it in places that have, partly because high energy costs. We haven't had high energy costs like this for a while, so that's made it more economical. I mean, you are going to have to float a bond and pay for this. But that's a long-range view, because then you become stable.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things I think we tend to think about in Hawaii is what it's going to be like in the next 3 or 4 years. And everybody's rushing to look at the rate cases and say, well, this will be better. I think that's a mistake. I think we have to look at it strategically and say, the prices are always going to vary. Some days, and some years perhaps, renewables won't lead to cheaper energy, partly because, like now, oil is so cheap that actually there's curtailment, and so you don't get the benefits of that. So you've got to look strategically, given the situation in the world, what are you going to do that's going to give you reliable, secure energy across a range of things? So the location issue is right. You're probably going to locate it in areas where there's a significant, maybe 800 or 1,000 foot drop. You've got to find spaces that are 5 or 10 acres on either side, but there are places like that.
And
that's
not
that
hard. Have you thought of some of those places?
I have. There are actually some proposals. There has been for the last 3 or 4 years an active discussion on the west end of Kauai. KIUC has been looking at using the Pualua Reservoir, which already exists. It's a state reservoir. It's only got about 60 million gallons in it now because of some dam safety issues, but it can hold over 250 million gallons. It's at about 3,000 feet. You could go down to the monoplane, which is right next to the ocean. You could build a pipeline right down through Dillinar land, and there's a straight easement down there. It's now a hunting road. You could put the pipe underground for ways over the edge, and essentially, you could generate 40 megawatts of energy just by that simple construction right now. People have been doing studies on it. I've seen some of them. They're totally financially feasible. It's just a matter of getting the work done. In fact, the Board of Land and Natural Resources approved in concept the studies a year ago.
And who's been doing those studies?
KIUC, which is the utility on Kauai. They've chosen to do it themselves rather than having a third party do it because they're not paying the third party's benefits and profits. So they're just going to develop it themselves. And that doesn't take net water out of Pulua Reservoir. It's just a storage facility. The water can still flow through there. It can still flow down the stream as it has before. So you're not taking more water out of a stream. You're simply using it as a storage capacity as the water goes up and down.
What about the arguments from, particularly on Kauai, we've had a lot of pushback for hydroelectric energy because of diversion of the stream, but more importantly, because of the interruption to some of the native species. And I'm trying to remember the name of the little fish that was
the opal. The problem with that, and I was involved in those back in the 80s, mm-hmm. those were run-of-the-river projects on the east end. In other words, they would block up some of the streams, divert the water away from the stream. Closed-loop pump storage doesn't involve a stream. Like I said, you could use salt water, you could use R1 treated water, you could use groundwater. It's basically water up, water down. Maybe there's some trans-evaporation issues. You could cover it and reduce that. But essentially, it's a closed loop. So you're not taking water out of the stream.
So are you suggesting, though, that the better use rather than a stream use would be, as you mentioned, wastewater treatment plants or water supply?
You want to start to co-locate your infrastructure. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're going to have to get away from having large wastewater treatment plants on our shoreline as sea level rises. Now, we have a little time to do that, but it would be crazy to put more large infrastructure on our shoreline. Mm-hmm. So as we start to wean ourselves away from that, we need to do more distributed systems, both in energy and in water and in wastewater. So we need to think.
That's a very important point, and that's not one that I hear raised very often, is that we talk all the time about distributed renewable energy, but you're saying we need to have all of our infrastructure distributed.
Think about this. Water and energy have relationships to each other, but they're not the same. Energy you can move a long distance fairly inexpensively. Water is heavy. It takes a lot of energy to move water. If you could take that energy and not have to move water, but use it close to where it is, you've reduced your overall cost on the water side. You could also use the fact of gravity to generate the energy to treat wastewater, for example. So you can have self-contained systems that are reliable, that are stable, and don't move things as far away from where they're used. And they're more closely aligned with the needs of that community.
Right, and you can move the water that is, you know, potable going to our houses much more cheaply because you're using renewable energy to do that pump storage, and that pump storage is then allowing the leveling and the potential to meet peak demand at lower prices.
We got to be careful. It's not necessarily true it's always going to be cheaper. Sometimes it may be more so, but it's going to be much more reliant or reliable given climate change and other things, so we don't have big systems that fail. I mean, a simple example. If the Kahi power plant were to be hit by a tsunami coming from Indonesia, for example, and it hit other parts of the southern coast of Oahu, that takes out a huge percentage, maybe half almost, not quite, of Oahu's power needs. You do not want to ever have everything in one basket. Now, if we had a small facility in a number of places, you might lose one. But if you lose one of two or three, that is so large that effectively the system stops. Water systems are a little bit different. They don't fail in the same way. But if you had more distributed sources of doing these things in local communities, each one would be reliant. It takes management. I'm not saying this is easy.
Could you have a pumped storage hydro system linked with a microgrid so that you have some of the energy security and redundancy issues serving specific small areas. So for example, if Kahe Point went out and you had a microgrid in a community like Manoa, and you had pumped storage hydro available as a backup to support that microgrid, would that be
a beneficial solution? If you think about some hotels located in remote areas that don't have access to the grid and don't have access to sewer systems, or frankly, public water systems. I mean, you think about Kona, the distances are long. A lot of those are standalone energy sections, mm-hmm. and standalone water systems and standalone wastewater systems. Mm-hmm. So the technology in this is really interesting because people are having to figure out how do you do all three of these at the same time. As that innovation occurs, then we're going to get better and better systems. The military, for example, has been doing this for a while and is doing it faster because they have to support troops in the field. So they're finding out what they have to do and how to be efficient about it. They can't afford to spend an enormous sum of money doing something that's inefficient. So I think that's where the innovation is going to occur, is how do you link those and make them work in a smaller system? And then you can take out that unit or put it back as you need, but you're not dependent on one centralized system. And so you're right, what's been going on in energy needs to go on in water and wastewater.
So you mentioned the studies that are happening at KIUC on Kauai. Do you know if Hawaiian Electric Industries or its potential merger partner, NextEra, is looking at pumped hydro, and have they done any studies?
I'm not aware of any. They may be, but I haven't heard of any. There's more interest actually in the neighbor islands. Maui's been looking at it seriously.
So Maui Electric Company?
No, not Maui Electric. A private company has been looking at providing. Maui Electric's about to come out, or maybe already has, with a request for proposals to retire one of their 40 megawatt power plants, Kahului, and it's a fossil fuel plant. So they need to come up with an alternative. So the question is, what is that going to be? One of the dangers of, it's the nature of the truth, that institutions that have been doing one thing for a long time have a very hard time changing. All of us are a creature of our own habits, but people who know fossil fuel power plants, that's what they know how to engineer. And so these people may do a good job, but they're not likely to be the ones to innovate. The innovation is going to come from a third party that says, I can do this smarter and better, let me try it, and I'll provide you with the energy you need and do some things you've never done before. So I think the innovation is going to come from other sources.
We need to go to a break, but when we come back, we'll continue with Bill and talk to him about where those innovations might be coming from. Aloha.
Okay, I'm Jay Fidel. That's Ray Starling. We co-host a show called Hawaii, the State of Clean Energy, every Wednesday, 4 to 5 p.m. It's really interesting. You know, Ray has a way of unzipping these guys. He asks them these questions, and all this stuff tumbles out, and we find out stuff we would never know about without Ray's questions. Thank you, Ray.
You're welcome, Jay. I'm very pleased to be your Ed McMahon every Wednesday at 4 o'clock here on the Internet. So you can join us and see what's happening in the energy world, and there is a lot going on. So join us every Wednesday at 4 o'clock.
Yeah, come around. Be energized right here on ThinkTech. Aloha.
Aloha, namaskar, and hello. My name is Anu Hittel, and I host the show called Climate Change Beyond Outrage. We go beyond outrage to find solutions to climate problems facing people, nations, and the world. I hope you will join me here every Tuesday at 1 o'clock. We broadcast live from thinktechhawaii.com. Aloha,
and bye-bye. Companies on the mainland.
Hi, we're back with Bill Tam, and we're talking about pumped storage hydro. Bill, you were talking before we went to break about it requiring some really innovative third party to come in and help us do this. I know some of the issues that third party would have to be very concerned with is the long lead time for development of projects in Hawaii, as everywhere, but we have some stringent permitting requirements, and also that would take interaction with the utility no matter who's doing the development. Do you see some potential third parties, or how some of organizations or the community could begin to move forward with this idea?
Sure. There's actually a lot of experience throughout the world. I mean, New Zealand's doing it, Japan's doing it. There are a lot of companies in the mainland that have experience with renewables. And so the experience is out there. It's not completely lacking. Ironically, Hawaii's small size is a deterrent because if you're going to build a project and takes the same planning, you might as well do 1,000 megawatts someplace as opposed to 40 or 50 here. So that is a problem.
I could see that being a very big problem. I pulled up a photo of one of the most successful projects in Wales, and I don't know if we have that of the Svelin, hard to pronounce, hydro project, but it's huge. I think it's a 360 megawatt project, and it looks like it takes up half of the mountainside of, here we go. I think this is in North Wales. And I think when people think of this, they may get very concerned about this size. How would we approach that? And you said it can be any size anywhere. Explain that so we're not overwhelmed by this.
Right, it would not be like that. That's a lot of concrete. I mean, essentially, because of our slopes, we have places that are relatively flat. And let's imagine you're on the south slope of Haleakala. You could build a reservoir that is essentially a hole in the ground.
Right.
Flat.
Right.
And there's no dam face to break. There's nothing that would fail on it. It's a reservoir here and a reservoir here that is two holes in the ground. I mean, they could be, frankly, large cattle ponds, although that's a
little... But would that pencil out financially if you're saying you might as well do 1,000 megawatts or...
No, what I'm saying is that the people who do these projects have a team of people, and it's more economic for them to build, say, in Texas, a large plant than to come to Hawaii to do it. Now, the reason they might come to Hawaii, a couple things. One is they may be able to do something on scale for Hawaii that hasn't been done before, that's an innovation of, say, combining wastewater energy and reuse wastewater and freshwater in some fashion that hadn't been done before. And they want to experiment. They don't want to do a huge plant. They want to try it out. We're the petri dish for a lot of things. Mm-hmm. We have high energy rates, so it may be economical for them to say, let's try and prove this, and if we prove it, we can bring people from all over the world here and show people.
And we certainly have plenty of elevation drop
right.
all over all the islands.
Right, and we've got the opportunity, and one of the things that I don't think people have thought about is reservoirs are valuable for other reasons besides the energy side. I mean, this may make sense because it provides, for example, when you're trying to put out forest fires, helicopters need a place to dump their bucket and take it out. So you've got a reservoir they use Pulua Reservoir, for example, to fight forest fires in Kauai. It is also a resource in terms of agricultural irrigation. If you have a dry spell, that water is available to put it into irrigation.
Right.
So you got to design it right. But what the benefit of that is you now have an integrated system. Now, there are people in the mainland who are prepared to come and do this. In terms of financing and time, I think you're looking at maybe 5 to 6 years. You got to go through the design and permitting phase. You could put it on ag land, not in conservation district, which would make it simpler. You can get federal money under some of the renewable energy loan guarantees that Congress passed in the last few years that is essentially, I mean, right now interest rates are low, but it's almost zero interest rate money. So I don't think the financing is the problem. I think it's the leadership to say, let's combine these and take a chance on starting something new. And once everybody sees it, then they'll go, oh, I can do that. It's like many things. You've got to see something working before you go, this is doable.
Right. So it would like a very innovative person who can work with a lot of different partners.
Right.
Particularly on the land side, on the water resource side, on the technology side, on the permitting side, and pulling all of those together and looking at how to integrate them, because the novelty there, right, is the more closed loop system where you're using distributed,
right.
Not just renewable energy, as you pointed out, but distributed utilities, be it wastewater or be it actual potable water delivery.
I think this is a perfect kind of project for a large landowner in Hawaii. I'll mention three or four, and it's up to them to decide what they want to do. Parker Ranch is perfectly situated. They're very interested in renewables. They're very interested in some of their own systems. They're talking about their own grid.
Mm-hmm.
Ulupalakua Ranch in Maui, I mean, is perfectly situated on that south slope of Maui to take advantage of something like that. They have a wind farm now. This would be a perfect way to store the energy the wind generates in the times when they're otherwise curtailed. I think that would be a very innovative thing for them to do, and Sumner Erdman is an innovative guy. Kamehameha Schools has lands that would be well situated, and they have a capital. So I think it's just a matter of people sitting down, figuring out the economics. Not asking anybody to, spend more than is reasonable. But those ranches and those large landowners can have a longer time period. They're not looking at a 5, 10, 15-year return. They're looking at a system that lasts. So they can afford to think long term. And I think the fact that they could do it on their own ag lands would make things simpler.
Of course, no one is going to pursue this until we know who the utility is, because they're going to have to get a power purchase agreement and, link in to the grid. So that is an obstacle that we're waiting for a solution for.
That'll be decided fairly soon. And I think the neighbor islands are probably more adept at this. I think Maui and the Big Island, Kauai's already doing it. So Maui and the Big Island should be looking at this really soon. Oahu, there are places on Oahu. Not to put too fine a point on it, but Lake Wilson in central Oahu, which is about 800 feet in elevation, has a storage capacity that is five times the size of Koloko. Koloko is
on Kauai.
On Kauai. People don't think of Lake Wilson as a large reservoir because you don't see very much. It's deep. It's back in the woods. But there is an enormous amount of water there. And you could use that as the lower reservoir and either go up on the Koalau side or the Waianae side, locate a space, and have the water go up and down.
Right.
You've got a lot of ag land there that can be served. It's just central Oahu is waiting for people to be innovative in ways that we have not thought about before.
One of the things I'd like you to weigh in on is, because we really would need the cooperation of the utility here, is what do you think is the trajectory for the merger decision between NextEra and Hawaiian Electric Industries? Or company.
I don't have a sophisticated judgment about that. I've been following the story in the newspapers and some blogs, but I'm not.
There was a great headline today.
There was.
That was very interesting.
My personal view is that we have to get control of our resources if we're going to sustain ourselves in the future, and it would be a mistake to look at short-term economic benefits as the sole reason for doing something. I have a view about energy and food prices in the future that are not consistent with the headlines in the newspaper. But eventually, we're adding 76 million people a year to the Earth. There is no way in 15 or 20 years, when you're adding another 750 million people, that the price and the pressure on both food and energy are going to drive both innovation and more stress. If we're going to get control of our future, we've got to get control of our energy, water, and food resources. The first one probably is going to be energy. That's the one where you can control things because it's price sensitive. The others are more difficult to engineer because food and water systems require different infrastructure investments, and they require a long-term view. So my view is we can get control of our future, but we've got to do it in a strategic way and not be at the mercy, frankly, of the forces outside of here. Now, we're never going to do it 100%. That's not what I'm suggesting. But we've got to do much more in a much more thoughtful way than we have in the past.
So today's headline said that NextEra is interested in having this issue settled, the merger, by June 30th or June 1st, I can't remember what it was. And they're very concerned that there be a decision made or they may pull out, was the headline. What will happen if NextEra pulls out of this merger?
Well, there'll be a period, if it happens, there'll be a period of angst, and then there'll be a period in which people say, okay, let's get our act together. And I think people can form co-ops like Kauai. Maui County's talked, the mayor's talked about that. Like I said, Parker Ranch and the Big Island have talked about it. It will put on the table the question of whether we have the initiative here to organize ourselves in the way we're talked about. It will require some smarts.
And so there isn't another company standing in the wings that might come in and...
I have no idea.
And make that play again for a merger with Hawaiian Electric?
I have no idea. That's outside of my knowledge.
One of the other issues that I think is important for the water with regard to the hydroelectric or hydro pump storage is potable water, and you talked about that in the last time that you came on, and the importance of recognizing that our potable water supply is actually diminishing, and you showed some very provocative graphs over time. Is there any way that this might be a solution for increasing potable water? How might this application look at that?
The thing we have to do first, frankly, is collect the rain that comes. That's the simplest thing, and that has to do with protecting the forests. Because if the forests get degraded, first of all, the heat is going to push the clouds higher, you're going to get less rainfall, and they'll pass over on Oahu, pass over the mountains. So the first thing is to protect the rainforests and make sure that the water lands. Then to make sure it percolates in the ground and does not run off. Then with regard to the groundwater, which right now we have enough of, we're not in immediate shortage, is there are a lot of conservation measures. You know, conservation in both energy and water are the low-hanging fruit. And we can do a lot of things that will extend our time period out before we reach a real problem. But we can't postpone that. And it's like your children's education. You can't say, well, they don't have to go to school for a couple of years, but they'll get into college later, we'll crash a course and do something about it. You got to start now. You have to start developing habits that will be useful later. If you postpone that, then it's like people having sugar rushes say, I'll stop eating the donuts tomorrow.
Could you, though, use pump storage hydro for helping to run a desalinization plant, for example?
Sure. I mean, that works. Desalinization has other problems because you've got to dispose of that brine. Uh-huh. And it's also, right now, desalinization is not economic. And it won't be for a long time because in Hawaii, the energy prices are just so high. You could start doing desalinization with cheap energy, but that's...
You don't see that as in our future.
I think it's an illusion. I think, obviously, the technology exists. And in places where they have really cheap energy, in the Middle East, at least until recently, you can do that. And if you don't have water from any other source, you do it. If you're on a ship, you got to do it. But the idea that you're going to run a society on a technology that depends on large brine and high energy costs, I think is myopic.
Okay. Well, thank you, Bill. I really appreciate you coming on and informing us of not only this great solution for pumped hydro, but of course, always your great water knowledge. And so I hope you'll come back and we'll pick your brain a little further with some more ideas.
I think there's great reason for hope, but it's going to require innovation. We can't just keep doing what we're doing. That's the key, I think.
That's the message we're going to leave you with today as we close Sustainable Hawaii, is that we are all innovators in finding solutions for sustainability. Aloha.
Hello, everybody. I'm IC Davidson. Thanks for tuning in to Think Tech Hawaii. One of the things that we do here, or the thing that we do here, is promote civic engagement in Hawaii. What does that mean? We want to talk about things that people want to hear about. And we want you to engage us and be part of that conversation. One of the ways that you can do that is by joining in during our live show via Twitter. How do you do that? Well, you get on the interwebs and get Twitter, get an account, and mention us if you have a question. What you'll do is you tune into our show live, tweet us questions, and our hosts and guests will address them accordingly. It's really easy, it's really fun, and I think that your participation in what we're doing here will help us continue the dialogue on very important issues that we're trying to cover. Sustainability, clean energy, you name it, we're on top of it. We want you to be part of what we're doing, because together we'll be able to make things change. Thank you for watching Think Tech Hawaii, thinktechhawaii.com, weekdays 12 to 5 p.m.
That was weird.
Yeah. Excuse me, next time, hopefully.